Welcome back to Let's Code. I'm Chris Biscardi, and for this week, we are upgrading to Bevy 0.9. Now, before we start out, I'd like to shout out to Hugo Reynal, who helped with the 0.9 upgrade by submitting PRs to the Bevy examples repo. So thank you very much, Hugo. This PR is kind of massive, but there isn't that much to go over, which I think is a testament to how much the Bevy team can put in without actually hard breaking many of the applications that actually use it. That said, we are pre-1.0 and 0.8 to 0.9 is technically going to be something like it would be a major upgrade. So let's get into it. This PR is fairly large. I do touch a lot of files. There's about 60 files changed. You can see here that it's a couple thousand lines of code added and removed. I've removed some of the examples that I don't think fit in the repo anymore now that we have a whole ton of them. And most of these examples revolve around shaders like you just saw. There is only one example that I wasn't able to upgrade yet, and that's because it uses Bevy Asset Loader. Again, 0.9 came out, I don't know, 3 days ago, so it's reasonable that crates haven't updated yet. Bevy Asset Loader and crates like Bevy Rapier are some of the later crates to update in my experience, especially if you're looking for a Bevy Asset Loader with IES loopless compatibility or something like that. Now, one thing I do want to point out that is not actually Bevy related is that due to the updates in Rustlang and Cargo, I am now using a root workspace dependency for Bevy itself. So I've upgraded the root cargo toml to 0.9. And then if we look at the, say, CandyCane example, we have workspace true under dependencies.bevy. This makes it easier for me to maintain the repo as we are getting quite a few different examples in here now. One change that's particularly interesting if you are using something like I've been doing where you copy some of the standard material code out and use it in one of your own shaders is that part of the standard material code has changed, and anywhere you have PBR input.n, that function has changed from prepare normal to apply normal mapping. Other than that, it was a pretty smooth upgrade for anything that copies a lot of the standard material shader code. Because plugins in Bevy 0.9 can now accept configuration themselves, we no longer have to set an asset server settings to make sure that our shaders, when we change them, or other assets, in fact, will update when we actually make changes. So now we can use default plugins.set asset plugin with that configuration. And this set API is new as well, I believe. So we've got default plugins, which is a set of plugins, and the set function allows us to replace just one of them with some configuration. Remember that due to the uniqueness constraints of plugins these days, in 0.9, we can't add multiple asset plugins, and if we add multiple, say, default plugin sets, we'll be warned about that. All instances of insert bundle, spawn bundle, or this pattern where it's spawn and then insert bundle, or spawn and then insert, I've changed all of those to use the new spawn API, which accepts any bundles. So in this case, it's accepting a single material mesh bundle, but in other cases, it also accepts a tuple. So in this case, we have spawn with a tuple that accepts a camera 3D bundle and the movable component as well as one of those tuple elements. The time APIs have changed name. So if you have access to a time resource and you're using something like seconds since startup, that is now elapsed seconds. And of course, because there's time scaling in Bevy 0.9, there's also the raw version of the APIs as well as the version of the APIs that are affected by time scaling. Everything I use as a resource needs the new resource derive on top of it. So that turned out to be a lot of the bind groups, a lot of any of the render pipeline customization code, any of the shaders where we have to do our own manual extraction and insertion of resources, all of those are going to need derive resource on them. Some crates like Bevy Inspector GUI are already updated for 0.9. So that was a super simple upgrade. Bevy Inspector GUI 0.14 is Bevy 0.9 compatible, where Bevy Inspector eGUI 0.15 is in a release candidate state. And while it's also compatible with 0.9, there are some larger changes in 0.15 and it's only a release candidate. So I didn't go with that release yet. Inside of the infinite tunnel example, you can see an example of the viewport changes. So before we could access view.width and view.height using the view bindings. That has changed to be view.viewport.z and view.viewport.w in our case. The viewport contains four values, the first two of which we don't care about, the third of which is the width, and the fourth of which is the height. But this comes in as a VEC4 now, for reasons I'm not quite sure of, actually. So we can get the third and fourth elements out of that VEC4 pretty easily by using z and w. Some crates, of course, are not updated for 0.9, like Bevy tweening. And we use Bevy tweening in the rotating column example. So instead of using a release, which hasn't been released yet, Bevy tweening has actually support on the main branch. So I included a revision for the git repo commit in my cargo toml for that example. In my case, it just worked. And I expect that that release will go out whenever the maintainer has a chance to do it. You will find, however, that some other crates are not even ready with PRs or something like that, which is totally understandable. It's only been a couple days since the release went out. The Bevy tweening APIs, if you care, changed a little bit. The tween new function got rid of the tweening type enum in favor of using with repeat count as sort of like a builder API on the back end of it. So in this case, with repeat count finite one, and that stacks with everything else that we had in here too. So we were using events with Bevy tweening, and with completed event just stacks right on top of with repeat count. If you have world access for some reason, like for example, in this case, we're using a custom command. So we have to use the world to actually spawn things in or get access to resources. The spawn API mirrors the one that we use sort of regularly with the commands. So this spawn will take a tuple, that is the bundles, and anything that you pass in, including any other components or bundles, will all get stacked in with that entity. In one example, we use the basic multi version of noise from the noise.rs crate, and this required me to make a small change to wrap basic multi in a sort of a new type wrapper is what I'll call it. So this is a tuple struct with just the basic multi inside of it that only exists to be able to derive resource for this struct. Now before, what we were doing is we were inserting a resource for basic multi, but now what we have to do is wrap that basic multi in my noise, which implements resource. We unfortunately, due to the rules of Rust itself, can't derive resource for basic multi because it's a third party trait and a third party type. So unfortunately, we aren't allowed to do that. There are good reasons that we aren't allowed to do that. Because for example, if you include two crates that both do that, which one gets used isn't clear. So they can have conflicting implementations at that point. But this is the way that I'm working around that right now, so that we can implement resource or derive resource for a struct type that contains the values that we care about. And then to construct and insert that, we just specify my noise and do the same construction that we did before for basic multi. When we go to use it, we can query for resource my noise or res my noise. And then when we actually want to use that value, because that basic multi is the first element in that tuple, we can do noise.0. Now there are traits called like deref and deref mute that we could potentially derive here to make this a little bit cleaner or whatnot. I chose not to do that in this case. I chose to go with just doing noise.0 because I only have two uses of it anyway. And that's it for the Bevy examples repo. So the upgrade wasn't actually too bad. We'll see what the upgrades look like when we go into the 2D platformer and the block breaker examples that we've been building on the channel. But to do those upgrades, we will have to wait for Bevy Rapier to upgrade to 0.9 as well, because they use collision detection pretty heavily. So that won't come until Bevy Rapier has upgraded. I feel like the upgrades are fairly mechanical when Bevy updates, and I don't actually have to do that much to make sure that my code works again, which is something I really always appreciate about the Bevy upgrades, because you can imagine having a bunch of examples like this, it can get pretty hard to maintain if there are too many breaking changes. But I never seem to have that problem with Bevy, which is super awesome and exciting. Like, I can't expect that for every release, but it is wonderful while it exists. So I hope you enjoyed the video and have a great rest of your day, and I'll see you in tomorrow.